philanthropist, co-owner of the Atlanta Dream, and a recently appointed honorary Georgia Tech alum. Please give a warm Georgia Tech welcome to our guest, Mary Rocket Brock.
Thank you. That's great. Thanks so much. That was a great introduction. It took a lot of my talking points, but that's okay. I have to say, I couldn't be more proud to be an official Yellow Jacket now after last Thursday night. That was quite an event at the White and Gold Ceremony, and it just made me thrilled to work on behalf of Campaign Georgia Tech to raise $1.5 billion for this institute. And I can promise you, at the end of my talk, when I've wowed you, I hope, I'm going to have a little commercial for Campaign Georgia Tech. So look forward to that one. Anyway, I did grow up with John Brock in a small southern town on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi, Moss Point. And you can see a picture of that here. It's right at the end of Lover's Lane. And I want to assure you, we were never there. But I have known John since I was 10 years old, and we have a lot of history together. And as you may or may not have heard, I was with John when he got his acceptance to Georgia Tech back in 1966, and it was a big day for him, and since then, for four decades, it's been very important to my life. So that's my background with John, and I'll move on to what I'm doing and why I'm really here today. As I went through my life and had my college years, finished my undergraduate degree and graduate degree at Miami University of Ohio, was an educator, had my family, worked in the community. There were many times when, due to circumstances of opportunity, location, or geography, I did the so-called reinvent myself. I'll be the first to admit that never in a million years did I think I would be here in Atlanta, Georgia, in my 60s, as the co-owner of the Atlanta Dream. I love to say in my 60s. One thing that Kelly Loeffler and I, my co-owner and I, love to say is that she is a product of Title IX, you know, when women were able to play sports, and I was pre-Title IX. So no, I did not play basketball. Kelly, who's about 5'11", did play basketball. Anyway, I never thought, as I said, that the Atlanta Dream would be in my life, but I'm extremely happy that it is. As we moved on, John and I moved on through our lives, I was involved in many organizations, whether it was heading up community events, organizations like our interest in AmeriCares, and that's what this picture is related to. John and I were on a trip to Malawi, which is where AmeriCares has some initiatives. John and I are big supporters of that. So those are the kinds of things that I was doing as I led up to my what I call my Atlanta years. Because in spite of the fact that John and I were married when we were at Georgia Tech, when he was at Georgia Tech, we never lived here in the adult world until 7 years ago. But as I was on various boards and doing things that, you know, were very important to me, I never thought that I would be involved in something that 3 years ago has turned out to be as inspirational as anything I've ever done. Never would have expected it. You heard in my introduction that I'm involved in organizations from trustee at Spelman College, again, women, to Usher's New Look Foundation, which speaks to my interest in young people and better lives for them, Horizons, many other things that lead to the intersection between what I've done before and why I do the Atlanta Dream. Okay, so I mentioned before, never would I have expected to be doing this, but how often, when you are in this decade of your life, do you get a chance to work at a business and have the chance to make it successful, not only as fun in sports? I mean, that's certainly a fact. This is a fun business, and we do enjoy it, but for Kelly Loeffler and me, we have as a clear goal to make the Atlanta Dream work as a small business, and that's no small goal. Why is it important that women participate in sports? I mean, I think that there are a lot of things in life that you say but you can't prove. But the outcomes for women in sports are very easy to prove. I mean, the statistics are out there. If you participate in sports at any time in your life, the probability that you will graduate from high school and college is increased. There are lower teen pregnancies. Your career in your 30s, clearly you have better careers in your 30s. And something that might interest some of the women in the audience and even the men in the audience is that if you look at executives in Fortune 500 companies or other successful companies in the U.S. and across the world, 80% of those women participated in sports at some point in their lives. And I have two good examples here that I can just call out because I know them. Julie Francis is a senior executive at the Coca-Cola Company. Great athlete, then and now, Julie. And Camille Foster, Nexidia. And I can guarantee you she's the first to admit that she's an IT Georgia Tech geek. And she's not mad at me for saying that. But anyway, Camille, again, an athlete then and now. But that's proven across the board. So clearly the outcomes are very good for sports. And we all know it could be music, art, drama. But what we're concentrating on and what I concentrate on is the impact that sports has on the lives of young women. Before I get into the business aspect of it, though, I want to discuss a little bit of the history of the WNBA. Back in 1996, for those of you who were here in Atlanta, or those of you who just know that the Olympics were here, David Stern, who was the NBA commissioner at that time, and who's still the NBA commissioner, saw the excitement around basketball, women's basketball. That was the first time in the Olympics that basketball had been a sport, and people were just overwhelmed with it, thrilled with it. And so he thought, gee, we've got these arenas of the NBA that aren't used in the summer, in the off season. Why don't we consider doing something that energizes people around women and basketball? 1997, 1 year later, was the inaugural season of the WNBA, and here we are now, still successful, still sustainable, and we enter our 17th season. And to be clear, there are a lot of sports for women that are important across the country. Soccer is one. We all loved watching the soccer team this past summer, and soccer is incredible. But it has been very difficult to sustain a women's soccer professional league. So, you know, for better or worse, it's sustainable. And we're very proud of that fact. Get a little of my Dasani. John insisted that I not have a glass up here. Julie would be happy about that, too. Anyway, did we go? Okay, so when the WNBA began, there were 8 teams. Some of those teams haven't been sustainable. There's been a little change. But today there are 12 teams, 11 on each team, Eastern Conference, Western Conference. You can see that the Atlanta Dream is in the Eastern Conference. Each year, only about 10 plus rookies, depending on the year, make a WNBA team, make the training camp, and it's really tough for that to be sustainable. Usually they have to play in Europe a few years, come back to the U.S. It's just a very, very elite league. 132 women. We have about 30 who are international. It's definitely the go-to league in the world for elite basketball. And so you figure of all of those seniors who are graduating and having played NCAA basketball, a very small number of them make the WNBA. And I said graduating. That's another key point that I haven't mentioned. One of the many differences in the WNBA and the NBA is that to be in the WNBA, you have to be a college graduate. And if you're an international player, you have to be 20. But most of those players are also college graduates. Like we have 2 international players, they're college graduates. So that's a key difference. These women are smart, well-spoken, good role models. I'm not saying the NBA doesn't have all those characteristics, but just think about that for a minute. We're very, very proud of that fact, and it makes for a very, very different league. 6 teams have the independent ownership model. 6 teams have a model that's part NBA, part NHL, WNBA, so multi-owners. There are only 2 teams that have women-only models, and those are the Seattle Storm and the Atlanta Dream. So again, we're very proud of that. Kelly and I think that's something that we think is very important and something we really want to make successful. Okay, here we go. There are 34 games. Let's talk a little bit about the game. There are 34 games per season, 17 home, 17 away. Some statistics, and we're Georgia Tech, right? Or you love numbers. So the three-point line for the WNBA is about a foot and a half longer than NCAA, 6 inches shorter about than the NBA, but we're working on that. We figure they could do it. The game length is 40 minutes. The NBA is 48 minutes. The shot clock, and this is a key statistic for the WNBA, the shot clock is 24 seconds. For the NCAA, it's 30 seconds. So a different game, but a real fast move for these college seniors who are coming into the WNBA. Very, very fast moving game. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about WNBA growth. Clearly, there are challenges in running this business. There's no doubt about it. However, every year we have more attendance, 10% growth in season ticket holders. The Atlanta Dream this year has a 20% increase in group ticket sales, 20% increase in merchandise, and all those things go straight to our bottom line. They're very, very important for us. Having exposure is very important as well. We have an ESPN deal that goes through 2016. It's a 7-year deal. That is very important. One night about which we're extremely proud is that the second game of the finals on ESPN in the 2012 season had a record audience. And I mean, that's what we all want, right? Record sales if we're in a company of sales, record audiences is if we want that kind of exposure. A draft. Yes, we have a draft. We're just like the big boys. There is a draft this year. It will be on primetime out of Bristol, Connecticut, which is where ESPN is located. It's going to be on April 15th at 8 o'clock, and it's going to be very, very exciting. This is a year where it's not only one player, like the year Maya Moore, an Atlanta player, came out of UConn, but we have three very, very premier players coming out of the college ranks. And I think it's pretty definite that these women will make the WNBA teams that draft them. And they are Brittany Griner out of Baylor. She is sky high, almost 7 feet, and yes, she can dunk. We say it's not important that we play a below the rim game, but we're okay with her dunking anytime she comes to Atlanta, because that's gonna bring everybody in to watch her. She's phenomenal. And Skylar Diggins out of Notre Dame, again, a very, very elite premier player. And Elena Deladon out of Maryland, again, a really, really good player. So they probably will go in that order to Phoenix, Chicago, and Tulsa, but they're all extremely good and they'll all be really fun to watch. Now, we aren't getting any of those players. We don't have a chance because our seasons and our records have been way too good, and it's just like the other drafts. The worse year you have, the higher draft you have. So those three teams are extremely lucky to be getting those players. Okay, league marketing and our partners. That's extremely important to us. If you look at the three areas that bring in our income, it's the gate, our tickets, it's sponsorships, our local sponsorships, and it's what we get from the league, passed down through the league. There are league sponsorships, and we get broadcast revenue as well, all passed down. So they do not sustain our league, but if they can sell, just like with the NBA, just like with the NFL, if there are league sponsorships, that comes down to the teams. So Boost Mobile in 1911 became the very first league jersey sponsor for the WNBA, and what that means is for the amount of money they paid, which was very significant, the Boost Mobile logo is on all of our jerseys. Now, it's really only so far on 10 out of 12 because two had a deal with other mobility companies, but that money still gets passed to them regardless, and in due time that will be on their jerseys as well. But that is a very key thing to happen league-wide, and it's very important to us as one of the 12 teams. These multi-year sponsorships, jersey sponsorships, can also be for independent teams. There are or have been 7 teams in the WNBA that have had jersey sponsorships. It changes from year to year. This year, I think there will be 5. Those are key to the bottom line of any team. They're usually seven-figure deals, and they're usually multi-year. So extremely important. In general, we're an expansion team, so in general, those have gone to teams that have been around longer. It's clearly one of our objectives. It would impact us hugely, and I would say it's at the top of our list. Okay, so getting down to a local level, I guess you can see this on either side, we have our own marketing sponsorships. Our two major sponsors are Coca-Cola and Aaron's. They've been sponsors since the dream began. They're very important to us. They're multi-year sponsors. So we always like to have a group of multi-year sponsors that are these two. We also have Grady Hospital, and we also have Georgia Power. We like to grow our sponsorships. In other words, we like to keep the ones we have and grow them. And then we also every year want new ones. We don't want to lose any. And we generally don't lose any, because our contention has always been that we reach a broad spectrum of audiences and a broad spectrum across the people who are out there, whether they're, you know, married or single or men or lesbian or whatever. You name it, we reach them all. And in fact, the audience segment that is usually said to be the one that's the toughest to reach are guys, you know, guys like John Brock, you know, who are in their 50s or 60s. It's like these guys think, you know, I don't want to watch a group of women play. But it's just not true. Get those kind of guys to our games, and they are blown away by the athleticism, the quickness, the interest. I mean, what they do is they look at it and say, this is the kind of game I used to play. Whereas in the NBA, it's wait till the last, you know, 5 minutes and it's all dunking. I mean, it really is. The entertainment value of our game is really, really huge. Our repeat ones are very good. We have one new one this year that I'll give you as an example, Equifax. We have some that have gotten bigger, like Domino's, and that's what we're always looking for. Now, the acronym that I have grown to not love over the last 3 years is ROI, return on investment, because you go talk to a sponsor and they want you to prove their ROI. If you've had that in your classes, just forget about it. It's like a bad word. If it's a bad word on our end, it's probably a good word on the end if you're trying to get value for your company. But it's a very hard thing to prove in the best of situations. I mean, if you look at Super Bowl ads, you can be sure it's very hard for those companies to prove they get their return on investment. However, it's our job to show them that they get some kind of a value for being a sponsor of the Atlanta Dream. And that's what we try to do. It might be that we reach their women's groups, we might reach their minority groups, but we really have to show that there's something we can do for them in addition to our community service. I mean, you're just not gonna say, I really wanna help young women, so let me go to a game. You've gotta go to a game because it's good entertainment value, and those things are important, but they're not going to sell sponsorships. I mean, I can tell you that from experience. So we have to do things like, an example up here, military appreciation, and it's sponsored by Domino's. They love it, our audience loves it. We have three aspects: on court presentation, in-arena presence, and PA announcements throughout the game. There are no bigger standing ovations and not any more energy than when this presentation is made. In fact, it's the only time that Kelly and I are on the court, other than, you know, maybe when I'm trying to drag John away from the yelling at the referees. But it's really a big, big deal, and everyone loves it. So that's just an example of the kind of exposure you can get. And then we also, as I said, are televised, I think I said, for all of our games by Fox Sports South. And that usually happens multiple times. Our games are shown once, and you can watch them again and again. So, you know, that's important as well. Now we are going to show a little video that I want to be in advance of talking about the Dream, our team. And so I think you're going to do that. Isn't that great? Now, if you're Val Peterson and you're at a game when that's going on, she's rocking out. Right, bud? Big fans of ours. So the dream, our team, our highlights. Okay, we're 5 years old. We're starting our sixth season, an expansion team. Our first season wasn't too great. We had to get 11 players from wherever, international, who we could get, who everybody else didn't want. However, we have made the playoffs in 4 of the 5 seasons. So since that first season, we've made the playoffs every single season. We're only one of 2 teams that's made the playoffs for the last 4 years, and those are our second, third, fourth, and fifth year. So that is phenomenal. Our second year, we did get the number one draft choice, Angel McCautry, and I'll talk more about her a little bit later. But we have made the finals 2 years, 2011, 2012, back-to-back Eastern Conference championships. And we feel like our record is, well, we know it stands up to a record like no other, and we can only get better and only go up. Angel McCautry, okay, she's our franchise player, no doubt. If you didn't want to come to a Dream game for any other reason, come to see Angel. She is amazing, and the way she works with the team is phenomenal to watch. She has many, many Dream records and many, many WNBA records, even in her 4 years. So she's played 4 years. We just signed her to a multi-year contract, and that's very, very important to us. The numbers are for Angel. Last year had the record for most points per game, 21.4, I think. Yeah, 21.4. She led the WNBA in steals in 2.5. She set the WNBA record last year in free throws, 17 for 17, back in June, last summer. She is just a phenomenal, phenomenal player. In the finals, and she's been in finals 2 times, she has the record for the most points scored in a WNBA finals, 38, and the most points scored in a WNBA playoff game, which is 42. I mean, this is a young woman who's only played out of the University of Louisville for 4 years. So we have great hopes for her. She's dynamic. She works the crowd. She's crazy. You know, she makes faces at her coach. You name it, she does it, but she's really fun to watch, and she's a dynamic player who's really the leader of our team. We have other players who are incredible. I mentioned Sancho and Erica, who are international players. Sancho has the record for the Dream for 82 steals in 2012. She and Armenti out of the University of Mississippi, still to this day has records at that school in track and basketball that are phenomenal. They both make, year after year, the WNBA first team or second team offense and defense. We have Tiffany Hayes, who was a rookie last year out of UConn, and she was in the all-rookie team. But you figure, this is a young woman who's taking final exams in, you know, May, June, starting the next day. I mean, we had some Georgia Tech players who did the same thing, who got their degree in the afternoon and played in a game that night. But she's a young woman who did, as it's very difficult for a rookie to do, came in and made a difference right away. We're really, really happy to have her on board. And our team, with all of our good records and steals, you can imagine that we also got the WNBA record last season for our most steals per team, which was 9.8. The Olympics were last summer in London, and we were well represented. Leading up to it, we had a lot of players who were on their national team, but we had 2 players playing in the Olympics, Angel for the Team USA and Erica for Team Brazil, and they were both really phenomenal. As you know, Angel and the team, or the team and Angel, brought home the gold medal. Angel, even though she wasn't a starter, and you know, in basketball, like in all sports, you always have your ideas about why different things happen. Gina was the coach, and the starters were all UConn. Surprise, surprise. But even not being a starter, she was the second leading scorer on the Dream Team. So when she's on the court, she's phenomenal. And she led in steals across all teams in the Olympics, throughout all the Olympics. So she was number one in steals. I mean, this young lady is fast. Okay. So thinking of the Dream as a business, I think we all know, and you guys either have been in business and are back in school, or you're undergraduates and you're going to be in business at some point in your life. What is the key? I'm sure you're hearing from your professors. It's all about leadership and teamwork, having good people in the right positions, making sure there's the right chemistry, that people work together. What's the magic formula? And it's ever changing. No one really knows, so you have to be ready to react to what's happening and react to those changes and make sure that you're always on top of the game. And winning in sports is the same thing, just like winning in business. It's that leadership and teamwork and having the right mix of people. And everyone from our CEO, and we have a CEO who started just at the end of last season, Ashley Preisinger, to our coaches, to our staff who are work around the clock staff, to everyone associated with the dream. And of course, Kelly and I offer, what we can do is say we're there to support you every step of the way. It takes every single bit of that. You've got to work together as a team to succeed as a team. You've got to function as a team, and you've got to be ready for change. So you look at business challenges that sports teams face, they're the same kind of business challenges that businesses face. We just announced new assistant coaches, one brand new, Julie Plank, who comes to us from much experience in professional basketball and much experience in college basketball. She played herself at Ohio State. Last year we had Joe Champy. He's a Hall of Fame coach. He was phenomenal. They're incredible. We have had a new head coach last year. And this is important. As I said, change is disconcerting at times, and you would rather be intentional about it rather than reactional, but you've got to play it both ways. And we've had, over the course of 5 years, two head coaches, three changes in assistant coaches, three ownership groups, we've had four CEOs, and of our original 11 players, we have two of them. Now, maybe that would make you think, whoa, is this a little dysfunctional? No, we're new, we're brand new. I mean, 5 years, this league is entering its 17th year, we're entering our sixth year. That's just what you've got to deal with. And we try to deal with it, as I said, in an intentional way most of the time, but we try to be ready to deal with it in a reactionary way if that's what we've got to do. Okay. Oh, I wanted to talk about the challenges with our players too, and this relates to the change. Our players, most of them, in fact, 10 out of 11 of our players, play in the off season overseas, from China to Turkey to Europe, other Germany, you name it, they play there, Russia, Israel. And the reason they do that is they make additional money, and that they need that. I mean, this, I said it's not the NBA in certain ways, and one way it's clearly not is they don't make the kind of money that you make in the NBA. That's why, one reason it's not 1 year and out. Why would they leave college to go and do that? They're not allowed to do it, but there's no point in it. It's not that kind of business model. So that's a challenge that we face. If they're playing 11 out of 12 months a year, we obviously have to deal with the fact that they might get injuries, that, you know, their focus is a little different, but, you know, it's the way it goes. They usually end their season in Europe and come straight into training camp. So that's a challenge. We also have, just like other sports teams, free agency to deal with. We have a salary cap that's $1 million. All teams do. You know, you can't come in and say, I'm Jerry Jones or Mark Cuban and, you know, or whoever, the Steinbrenners, you know, you can't do that. It's very, very controlled. We think that makes for a competitive league, and it's the only way to really grow this league to have those kind of controls into place. So we don't disagree with that at all. And then, obviously, these players play on their national teams. Back in 2011, we were in the finals, and Erica De Souza, who was playing for Team Brazil, had to go and play two games for her country and miss two games with us, and we were headed toward the finals. I mean, that's really, really tough, but that's something that we just have to deal with. It's part of change and part of reacting to that. I mentioned in the beginning that there was a real intersection in my interest historically and what I've done with my life, whether it's education or community service, and what I see with the dream, and there's clearly that intersection there. I told you that our goal is to run this as a business and to succeed as a business, and that's very true. But the intersection of the personal interest and what we do with the dream is important. We have something called WNBA Cares. WNBA Cares And actually, there's NBA cares, too. I don't want to completely diss the NBA. But it's where you really feel that there's a responsibility for these players to go out into the communities and talk to youth groups, to go to hospitals, to go wherever it's thought that they would make an impact. And we clearly think that. Now, it can be league-wide or it can be based in Atlanta only. And we have everything from Dream Pink to reading to hospital visits to Usher's New Look is involved. Horizons, this organization I'm involved with, is involved with the Dream. Anything that we can do, either Boys and Girls Club, to get people to our games or to go out and visit them in the community, we think that's important. And with the role models that we think these young women provide, we think that's something that's important to us. Now, it goes both ways. You know, we want to do that, but we also feel that that the community needs to give back to us. Kelly and I say that owning the Dream, and I don't mean this in a negative way, I'm going to tell you that up front, owning the Dream is not a philanthropy. Not a philanthropy. Atlantans need to take ownership of the Dream. This isn't going to succeed because Kelly and I just say, we're in this no matter what. I could say I want to give my money to Georgia Tech. And actually, I have given my money to Georgia Tech. But I really believe that I can also work with a Dream and make a difference in the lives of young women and their futures, and I think this is something that's important to do. And whether you're Bud Peterson running this university, whether you're John Brock and running Coca-Cola Enterprises, or Steve Salbu and running the business school, everybody wants to win. I mean, winning is really what it's all about, right? In whatever your category, whatever your business is. And so we do want to win. We want to win a WNBA championship. We think that we can do that, and we think, you know, winning always, the better you do in your business, the better the business gets, right? So the more we win, the more people come to our games, the more we energize the community. So it really is something that has got to go both ways. We want to give back to the community, but we feel like it's incumbent on the community to give back to us. Before I round this out, and Barrett Carson's going to be so happy I'm doing this, I promised you a Georgia Tech commercial. Now, I said that of the things I've done in Atlanta, one of them is work with John on Campaign Georgia Tech. So here you are, either undergraduates or graduates, and you're going to go out in the world as a Georgia Tech graduate. And you might think that's important now, but I can tell you, based on our travels around the country, from Atlanta to all 50 states, I feel like, to trips to Europe, and there's going to be a trip to Asia coming up, we find Georgia Tech graduates are so energized by having that in their background. I mean, if you think it's important now, you're just going to think it's more and more important as time goes on. And so what we always say is figure out what hooks you, what's your interest. You know, do you really value your management school professor or your chemical engineering school professor? Do you feel like you were lucky to come to Georgia Tech and you want to make that possible for other students and scholarship? Do you want to help endow a building, whether it's in a small way or a large way? Like, all of you are beneficiaries of this wonderful couple, Ernie and Roberta Scheller. And so now you attend the Scheller College of Business. I mean, this is a guy who started giving back to Georgia Tech as soon as he graduated, building his business, having no idea that he would ever be in the position to give $50 million back to Georgia Tech. Now, that could be any of you. You just never know. So I would just like to encourage you to think about that because it's important to the Institute, and I think it's something you're going to want to concentrate on in your future. Now, we usually end up campaign videos singing the Ramblin' Wreck. Not going to do that today. For one thing, Bud and Val had to leave to go welcome the new athletic director at Georgia Tech. So we usually have them up on the stage with us. Definitely not going to do that. I would just like to say that I've done a lot of things with and for Georgia Tech, and this has been among the most fun. When Steve Salbu asked me last fall, I think, if I would like to do it, I thought, wow, what a great opportunity for the Atlanta Dream, and what a great opportunity for me to stand up and talk about our business and how important it is to us and how important I think it is to Atlanta, Georgia. I would be happy to take any questions.
Mm-hmm. Mary, I have a question right here.
Hi, thank you for coming out. Your speech was great. I just have a quick question. What did you do between the first and second year owning the Atlanta Dream to make it so successful in such a short amount of time?
Okay, well, the first year was 5 years ago, as you've heard. I wasn't involved with the Dream at that time, but the key was for sure getting a number one draft pick, Angel McCautry, but it was also putting together a team that was made up of people who could support her kind of play. The Atlanta Dream is a really fast team. For those of you who are fans, I know we have a season ticket holder here, and then we have a couple back there. I've already called them out, so I won't mention their names again, but I hope a lot of others of you have been. In fact, I haven't even brought this out, but Atlanta Dream jersey. I should have worn this today, practice jersey, that I have to give back in a minute. I know. But if you see our team play, we're a really, really fast team, and it's always been said that it's the chemistry that draws them together. They weren't all first-round draft picks. They weren't all even second-round draft picks, but they all have something in common, and that's the speed of the game. Many times in the fourth quarter, our team is still going strong, and we just outlast them. I mean, we absolutely outlast them. So I would say what happened from first to second year, sure, the number one draft pick, but also starting to build this team with the right chemistry to be a winner. And I think it's the same thing in business. You know, if you're going to succeed, it's because you've put a group of people together who can, you know, work toward a common goal, work as a team. I mean, a superstar is great, but you're generally not going to win because you have one superstar, just like, you know, whatever your business, Nexidia, as good as Camille is.
Thanks for coming today.
Thank you.
I'm curious about your economic model. It sounds like salaries are under control because of the salary cap, but I'm just curious about a couple of things. First of all, what are the, what are your major challenges economically in terms of running the Dream? What are your major revenue sources? And is the Dream actually a profitable operation at this point?
Okay. One thing that I can say pretty clearly is we can't cut costs to profitability. We really can't. I mean, there are a lot of companies where you can do that, a lot of businesses where you can do that. That is clearly not something we can do. You know, the costs are really pretty set. I mean, they vary per team if some team spends more on marketing, but the costs are going to be fairly set, around $5 million, more or less, depending on the team. Our business model, I told you our income is the three different ways, our gate, our sponsorships, and our league. So I think the best way for us to reach that profitability level, and I would say we're moving toward that. In fact, we are moving toward that year after year after year. If we weren't, we wouldn't be doing this. If we didn't think we could do it, none of us would be doing it. But it's bringing up attendance and bringing up sponsor levels. Clearly getting a jersey marquee sponsor would impact our bottom line a lot. Of the teams that, and they're all private, so it's not public information. We, you know, no one knows for sure, but the ones that we think are profitable generally are ones that share ownership with the NBA, because obviously they share back office expenses. And so, and, you know, maybe they don't pay for their arena, we pay for our arena. And then one team that's independently owned is a team in Connecticut that's a casino, and so they have a big gate. You know, you gamble a little and you go to a Dream game. But if we, you know, we're moving toward that every year. As I said, our ticket sales are up, our group sales are up, our renewals are up, our merchandise is up, our sponsor, we don't lose sponsors, so that's what we've got to keep doing. We've got to keep increasing the sponsor levels, not losing our sponsors, and getting new sponsors. Sure.
Do you have any kind of relationship with the Atlanta Spirit?
With the Spirit, you know, the Hawks, it's really, really more just the Hawks now, since they are, the ownership group is still called the Spirit, but it's really the Hawks. They own the arena, so one of our huge costs is paying for that arena. You know, we pay for that. Whereas, as I said, if you're affiliated with an NBA team, you wouldn't have that cost, or certainly your cost would be reduced. So, but do we have a relationship? We have a relationship. Absolutely, and I would say it's an improving relationship. It's a challenging relationship, because obviously we would like to pay less. You know, they would like to get more. But we really are trying to look for ways that we can partner with them. We're trying to prove our value to them. 17 nights a year in the summer, the arena would be dark. And there certainly are conventions, and there certainly are concerts, but it would be very hard for them to replace 17 nights a year. And then we bring a community visibility to their games. So we constantly look for more ways that we can work with the Hawks in a positive way.
Could you start playing at Georgia Tech?
That is a very good question, and I'd like to tell you, size-wise, like, Phillips is about 10,000, a little over 10,000 people. Georgia Tech is, what, 8,000, I think. It's more to our size, and obviously we know it's a blowaway design. The light, everything from the theater lighting. So we have clearly talked about that. There's a new athletic director in place. Clearly we'll talk to him about that. Is it out there as a possibility? Out there as a possibility. It would be amazing. And I think we'd love to have, if we get into the playoffs this year, which we have four of our 5 years, the last 4 years, we're going to have some challenges with Phillips. So clearly we might even look this summer to have a kind of have a practice game there to see how it goes. I know there are a lot of Georgia Tech fans in here who are attending all these basketball games. So I think it would be exciting, and it's certainly logistically doable. So there you go.
Mary, my name's Luke. I'm a former or graduate, and I played football here, and wanted to say thank you for you and John for donating the lead gift for the football arena. So that was very near and dear to my heart, and where players are running at 6 a.m. right now. Also, the current students, want to give a quick plug. Gary Jones teaches a class that John speaks in. That's how I first got to meet them and sat next to the family today. But I had a two-part question. First is, you spoke on the community service with the Atlanta Dream and the Atlanta Give Back. Will you comment on that, and also comment on, you and John are both very, very busy, and will you comment on how your family interaction has, how do you fit that in as well?
That's a good question. Well, I don't know if any of you read last week's article by Henry Unger in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, but he has this five questions for the boss. And the very last question had to do with having three lists, I guess personal John Brock list, John and Mary list, and business list. And if you're in the bottom 20% of that list, if you're one of the items in the bottom 20%, it never gets done. So I would say, you know, Georgia Tech's not in the bottom 20% of that list. Neither is the Atlanta Dream. But I think life is full of setting priorities and figuring out how you're going to spend your time. We actually spend a lot of time with our family. You know, we have four grandchildren. I don't even know if I mentioned that. I certainly should have. But we love our three children. We have four grandchildren with our first two kids. Actually, our youngest son's girlfriend's here. They have no children. I think in life it's all about saying what's important to you. And, you know, clearly, you know, John runs a company, and his ultimate responsibility is to shareholders. You know, I'm part owner of the Dream. Kelly and I have a responsibility to our team. But then we have a lot of things that we're interested in. And, you know, John and I feel really, really lucky. I mean, some people look at where they are in life and say, oh, I got here because I'm so smart, or I'm so good, you know, or naturally I made it. And I guess John and I feel that, yeah, we've both worked hard, and I guess we're smart enough, but we feel like a lot of life is fate and, you know, I don't know, being in the right place at the right time. So if you are fortunate enough to be able to do things, either for your university, for the community, you know, it's what you should do. We just really believe that. And so it's not, oh, wow, that's such a good thing to do. Regarding the football practice facility, I never thought that we would do something like that, because we're really interested in cancer research and, you know, endowing scholarships and all that kind of thing. But when they talked to us from the athletic department about the practice facility, the whole point, and I think we all know this, if you have a better football team, it's just statistically proven that you're going to probably increase the quality of the students and the interest of the alums. And so it made sense to us to do that. That for me, that was originally a stretch, not a stretch so much for money, but a stretch of, like, are we really going to do this? And then I guess we also believe in, and Barrett, who's here heading up development for Georgia Tech, that if you believe in something, you might as well tell other people that you believe in it. Like, you know, I'm going to a Spelman College event tonight on wellness. I mean, we've actually decided to give up competitive sports and develop the premier wellness and fitness and nutrition program among historically black colleges and universities, because we think that's important to do. You know, I'm going to be there. Usher's New Look, same thing. You just got to say what's important to you, and you can make the time to do it. Christy is here. Christy works with me, and she's amazing. But, you know, she knows it's all about prioritizing how you spend your time.
Ms. Brock, thank you for coming this afternoon. I was curious as to what your relationship is and what that looks like between you and your coaches and players.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Fred Williams is our head coach, and our assistants, you saw their pictures up here, Julie Plank and Joe Champy. And I would say between Kelly and Ashley and me, we talk to Fred or communicate with Fred almost every day. Now, he's the coach. He makes the decisions. If he said, you know, I want to trade Armenti and told us why, you know, I'd be really unhappy because I like Armenti. But that's his job. It's his job to put together a team. But we have a very open and a very good relationship. When we were looking to hire Julie Plank, we all talked to her. You know, we met with her. You know, we communicated with her. We tried to, once we wanted her for the job, we really worked on selling her on the job. And the same with Joe. You know, we're in a lot of communication, but they really are the boss as far as the team. You know, I'm just like any of you. I watch, you know, we're in football, it's the armchair quarterback. In basketball, it's, you know, wringing your hands. You know, we'll think, why are they subbing, you know, Armenti right now? You know, she's got the most energy on the team. Or, you know, why aren't they starting, you know, whoever? You know, I'm sitting there saying the same things. And, you know, he doesn't really have to answer to us on that. Or we might tell him, but he doesn't have to give an answer. But relationship-wise, we have a good relationship. As I said, it's our job to put the best people in place. And sometimes that's, you know, that's a tough thing to do. But that's what our job is. But once they're in place, it's our job to support them and communicate with them.
Hey, Mrs. Brock. I had a quick question on the NBA or WNBA market as a whole. So it's kind of been evident in recent years in the NBA for superstar athletes to go to larger market cities. Mm-hmm. Do you see that trend kind of occurring in the WNBA as well?
Well, we have a whole spectrum of cities and sizes. I mean, everything from LA and New York and Chicago to Tulsa, you know, and here's Atlanta in the South. I don't think we do see that trend. I mean, we just lost a free agent. We had a player who was an unrestricted free agent, and I still am so interested in, you know, her career, and I hope she does well. Lindsay Harding was an unrestricted free agent, and she decided to go to LA. You know, it's a decision she had to make. We would have loved to have kept her. We have Jasmine Thomas coming in, who coincidentally, like Lindsay, is also a Duke graduate. This is her third year in the WNBA, so she's a young player. She was an academic All-American at Duke for 2 years. She's the only Duke basketball player to ever be an academic All-American. So, you know, that's change. So here we have an example, leaving Atlanta, going to LA. Lindsay had a lot of reasons for doing that. You know, I don't want to speculate on them, but we haven't seen that massive movement. I think some of that is not only going to big markets, but some of the bigger markets in the NBA or NFL or others also have the bigger salaries. And, you know, we definitely don't compete on salaries. I mean, once you've played 4 years of your rookie contract, then you have a little bit more leeway. But we have a salary cap. I mean, our salary cap is less than what most of the lowest level NBA players make. But that's a good question. I'm going to keep my eye on that since we lost Lindsay.
Because your players are playing year-round internationally, How does that affect the way that you set up player contracts?
Well, our contracts are for the season. So when they play internationally, you know, we have no control over that. We can't say, don't do it. I mean, are we interested in them, and do we keep up with them? And in fact, do our coaches, and in fact, this year, our newest assistant coach, Julie Plank, and Ashley Preisinger, our CEO, are going to Turkey because we have four players playing in the Istanbul area. It's kind of amazing. I mean, you might not immediately think Istanbul would have four women's basketball teams. I mean, they're not really known for, you know, being that pro women, frankly, but they love basketball, and they all play in the soccer clubs. So there are some major soccer clubs across the international group, and that's where they play. Now, you know, since we have so many in that community, we really want to try to make inroads and maybe get to know those clubs a little bit better, and we think that's important. But our contracts are for our season, if that helps. Now, as I said, we worry about injury, and if we had our choice, I guess if we had our choice, they wouldn't do it, although we 100% understand why they do from a financial perspective, because they can make a lot more money.
I think we'll make Terry the last question.
Okay.
I have a good enough question to be the last.
That's okay.
This has been wonderful. Thank you so much for all you do and for being
Thank
here
you.
Today. I'm interested in this multi-team system. I mean, there's so many teams. So as an owner, when are you in competing with the other owners' teams, and when are you all working together in a collaborative fashion to move the WNBA forward?
Well, on the court, we're competing, absolutely, all the way. But we always look to each other for best practices, because what do all of us want? We want the Atlanta Dream team to succeed financially. Why do we? Because it's got to be sustainable. You're not going to find someone who just endlessly, you know, pours their money into something that's losing money. And if we didn't think it would succeed, we wouldn't be doing it. So we want this team to succeed. We want the league to succeed. Now, it has succeeded for 16 years. We're moving into the 17th year. And as I said, it's not subsidized by the NBA. League sponsorships come down to us, but certainly that's it. You know, we're not, and so some teams do better than others. So it really is an advantage to us to share all the best practices. If someone gets a marquee sponsorship, they share with everyone who that sponsor is, how they got them, the steps that were taken, you know, what they used to win them over. They're very open about the money that it is, you know, how much money did they get, how many years. There is no reason not to share that kind of information. Because if we come across someone, and we actually did here in Atlanta, International Continental Hotel Group, IHG, and we were interested in them as a sponsor for us, and it ended up they were a league sponsor. So if we come across a company that we think would be good as a league sponsor, and we have, and we have some in mind now, we would talk to the league about that. That would be very important for us to do. So it's important to all of us. I mean, we don't want any team to fail. Sometimes people say to us, is the WNBA thinking about adding another team, like going from 12 to 13 or 14? And I would say that's not on their radar screen, because the most important thing is to make sure the current teams are sustainable. That's the best thing for the league. So good question, but we absolutely share everything.
Well, thank
Thanks.
You.
That's a good question.
Mary, I just want to thank you so much for speaking today, and if I could just get a round of applause from everyone here.
Thank you.